our Father, and our God, our Redeemer, our Savior, our hope, our joy, our future, our peace, our success, our dream, our everything. We want to thank you for the marvelous grace. The grace that was enough for all the sinners, including myself, God. The grace that looks beyond my sin and sees my need. The grace that goes beyond my strivings and comes to my rescue even before asking. The grace that covered me and made me spotless, past, present, and future, dear Lord. The grace that made me a son and child of God. The grace that made me, dear Lord, it made me a co-heir with you. The grace that made me a co-ruler with you. Where you stand, I stand. Where you are, I belong. The grace that makes me look at as blameless. The grace that recreated this world anew. The grace that gives us a reason to live on every day. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. May that grace teach us even this evening. In Jesus' name. Okay, I want to thank the Lord for the fire he has brought us. Today is the 30th of January. Hello? Yes. Today is the 30th of January, the last fellowship. I think we have another fellowship tomorrow. Tomorrow is our last fellowship in the year. Tomorrow at exactly 4 p.m. we'll be visiting one of us. Amen. One of us somewhere in Boys. I think you are aware. We have some ministry to do, and I want to believe that we are all in Hygeia. We have set ourselves to go and do that ministry tomorrow. And for some, I think tomorrow is our last fellowship of the year, of the month. And today is the 30th, so meaning that for those who made resolutions, you have laid the foundations. Have we? Blessings, my pastor, blessings. I have done the same as well, so I don't know how about you, but I'm moving. You see, usually in the first periods of the year, we say, Happy New Year, these are my resolutions. This year, I'm going to get a Muzungu husband. This year, I'm going to get a big belly. This year, I want to be fatter than Pastor David. You know, this year, I want to be taller than Elder Opio. We make the resolutions that we're like, this is my year, isn't it? But we stop at saying it. Usually I love to ask people after a month that how have you done these things differently between this year, which is your year, and that year that you said you don't want to remember? Think about that. We are taking a text from the book of Genesis, chapter 19. And verses 17 and 26. The Bible says, and when they had brought them forth, they said, flee for your life. Do not look back or stop anywhere in the valley. Flee to the hills, lest you be consumed. Verse 26. But Lot's wife behind him looked back, and she became a pillar of salt. I want to read again. And when they had brought them forth, that is from the city, they said, flee for your life. Flee for your life. Do not look back. Or stop anywhere in the valley. Flee to the hills. Flee to the hills. Flee for your life. Don't look back. Don't stop in the valley. Flee to the hills, lest you be consumed. But Lot's wife looked back, and she became a pillar of salt. Remember Lot's wife. It's the title of our presentation. Remember Lot's wife. I would love to tell a story. Someone wrote the words of this song and said, I've come too far to look back again. There is nothing behind me. All the pleasures I used to love have all faded from view. There's a new day ahead for me. My heartache is over. You see, I left it at Calvary, where my new life began. I've come too far to look back. My feet have walked through the valley. I've climbed mountains, crossed rivers, desert places I've known, but I'm nearing the onshore. The redeemed are rejoicing, heaven's angels are singing. I've come too far to look back. Listen, look around, there's unhappiness. Some see no reason for living. Life will give you a broken dream, full of heartache and fear. But turn around, don't look back again. Face the new day before you. Take your heartache in Jesus' name. He will mend broken dreams. I've come too far to look back. My feet have walked through the valleys. I've climbed mountains, crossed rivers, desert places of gold, but I'm nearing the onshore. The redeemed are rejoicing, heaven's angels are singing. I've come too far to look back, but I'm nearing the ocean, varied in the rejoicing, and heaven's angels are singing. I've come too far to look back. Thank you for listening to that poem. You know, the city once attractive for its beauty and its treasure, once sought after for its fun and excitement. Once upon a time, it was a source of fulfillment. The city that he chose when he and Abraham each had to choose one city. The one he opted for. The city that was loved by him. It must now be abandoned because of its danger. You see, if you've played football or watched football, it feels good to hold on to the ball, isn't it? You juggle it around. You know, you dodge a few people. It feels good to be with it because one of the things that a footballer loves is to have the ball on his what? His feet. But however nice it feels, ladies and gentlemen, a time comes when you have to pass it on or lose it. If you fail to pass it on, you'll be forced to lose it to your opponent. But you just can't hold it, hold on to it forever. Such is life. And you see, you can't pass the ball and have it. Once you pass it, you've passed it. You can't pass it and have it. The moment you raise it, your teammate, you just have to wait for a return pass. And you see, by the time the ball comes back to you, it is a constant. The score is always 0-0. It can only stay that way if no one scores. But if you score, or your opponent scores, the score becomes 1-0. Are we together? Now, it can only be 0-0 if no one has scored. As soon as someone scores, even if you equalize, it becomes 1-1. Simply because 1 minus 1 is 0, that can't make the score 0-0. Am I talking to someone? The game of football starts when it is 0-0, 0-0. It can remain that way as long as no one does what? Scores. As long as one team scores, let us say your opponent scores, the game ceases to be 0-0 and it will never be 0-0 again. It will have to be another game. The moment they score, even if you equalize and it becomes what? 1-1. Mathematics tells us that 1 minus 1 is what? 0. But can I tell you something? One one is different from 0-0. That is why they don't write 0-0, but 1-1. Simply because 1 minus 1 is 0, it doesn't make it 0-0. The game can never be 0-0 again after a goal has been scored. You can't lose your virginity and have it. Even if they manufacture a new, they call what, hymen? Huh? Is that what it's called, doctor? Yeah, even if they give you, you know, another artificial hymen, or they manufacture another one, it is never virginity. Because that new hymen is a manufactured one. Or it is a new one. You see, be careful wherever something has a qualifier. It means it is not the origin. I don't know if I'm making sense. Let me bring it this way. Once married, you cannot be unmarried. You cannot be a bachelor again. After marriage, you're either married or divorced or separated or a widow. But you can't be a bachelor again. So you cannot undo certain things. Thus, if you make a choice to move forward, you are indirectly choosing to forget where you were. Indirectly, cautiously or subconsciously. Any attempt to return where you are is called a return, not a turn, but a return. It is called negative movement. And the thing about negatives is because they are always negatives. A negative means subtracting. It means going back to where you are. It means there is lost energy. We have time lost. The resources lost. Every time you attempt to negate something, you are saying you are planning to lose something. You can't have a child and cease to have one unless the child dies. Even if the child dies, they will say you had a child but died. They can never say you've never had a child. Returns are always qualified by a re. And negatives are always negations. Remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. You know, I do think, I'm not an engineer, but I do think the more you break down something to rebuild it, the less trustworthy we are in that thing. Singo zimenyuma nedwa ku break no gimenya okutupaka wakati kati no damu no gatabula kwa kisude zaacha kuri fenna ekizibe de kibe yanga chita chamye ko ngachizimbibwa. Chechitegeza okugezaako oku undoing the things. Enyumba bw'ogizimba birosalawo okugimenya olw'okuba ng'olina kyeweerabidde oluzinga amabulooka, luzinga omusenyu, ofiirwa siminti, ofiirwa obudde, leba gwewasasula tayinza kuba y'omu agenda okuddamu okutereeza. Tuli ffenna oba fundi oli yakola olina funa fundi walwa mulala. So every time you make an attempt to go back You're making a choice to make a loss.
I'm convicted to think that that is why God is so much against the idea of backtracking. Agaba bana ba Israeli bwe muva mu nkambi y'omulabe mukole mutya temukwata yadde ku ki byonna mubireke mutyamule mukole mutya bwasanga Lutti amugamba fuluma duka toyimirira totunula mabega okusa ngobuse ku ki
Colossus.
But you look at Sakura Musam. Adamba, it will have been a terrible attitude. A sour room to where they took. I Casoria Tatawatia Munyumba. Nani Musu Tatawa. Gaina with
Gaina with Remember Lot's wife. Let me talk about these personalities in a few minutes.
I want to take a wild guess that we, at least each of us here, has an idea of, about the, I mean, of the story of Lot. Chikuru mubyeni mukwogera okusiza mu story. Bwe bamala okusalawo okuzikiriza ekibuga, the Bible says, Lutti n'asaasiwa. Lutti n'akola atya? N'asaasiwa. N'ategeezebwa, tegeka ennyumba yo. Your wife, your in-laws, whoever is part of your household, your daughters, or whoever you are, the Bible says, "Aba hesitating, malaika naba kuata kumuchi, kumukono naba tambuza, naba tu sewe, baba tu sewe, naba gamba katimochimoka tu kuzetuchia, tu vunde mo tu follow me." Now, these are the instructions. One, run. Verse 17, chapter 19. Run. Flee for your life. Listen now. Now, do not look back. In simple terms, if you want your life to be spared, these are the what? The instructions. Do not look back. There is something about looking back when you're running. But what I have to say, every time you look, you can't run and look back at a constant speed. Can you? You have to slow down. So looking back kills momentum. It means after turning to look back, bw'obaddamu okudduka olina okwakiseleratinga butoka tadukanga musere batugambanga buli lwatulebaga bagenda kukola batya kukuyisa. Why? Gw'okyuka okutunuulira akyali ku constant speed. Gwe ogendezaki speed, kitegeeza by the time you regain momentum aba akoze atya, akuyiseeko. We look back because we are curious about what is coming from behind us. Oftentimes we are tempted to look back because we have there are certain things that we treasure where we are coming from, and we want to see whether or not they are still intact. sometimes we look back simply because we do not understand why we are told not to look back. So because of reverse psychology, when they tell you not to look back, you actually look back. Don't touch, wait for it. That is the mind of a human being in a broken setting. You see, the challenge of looking back is that you can look back and see the same things that you used to do and you apply them in the process of going forward, yet there are some things that failed you in the first place. The problem of looking back is that there could be things that might hinder you from running along, because that's when you realize that your child is actually staying behind. So because of the parental love, you want to turn back and help out your child, not knowing that you're losing your life. The challenge of looking back is that you might be thinking that I want to see what is the position of my wife right now. Is she still following? And before you know it, you've become a pillar of salt, and the one you're looking back to see whether they're still following actually pass you by and continue, and they never look back to see how beautiful the pillar of salt you've become.
I'm talking about looking back. Remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife.
God was telling Lot, however beautiful Sodom is, it doesn't matter how many memories you have about the city. It doesn't matter how many friends you're losing in the process. It doesn't matter how much property you're losing in the process. If you want to save your life, if you want to retain your life, if you want to see the next day, you have to forget. You have to forget. Forget.
There is such a thing like forgetting if you have to be saved. That is why salvation is a personal thing, relationship with God. You cannot be saved because of what your dad has done or not done. You cannot share in that, because God is a personal God. He particularizes to universalize. When he's my personal God, his personal God, his personal God, your personal God, he becomes the universal God. Now, the mistake is to think that simply because he's the God of your pastor, that because of that it will be passed on to you. He is a personal. You have to forget when you're making a decision to move in faith with God. You have to forget the most loved one. You have to forget your child, elder, Lord have mercy. You have to forget your daughter. You have to forget your son. You have to forget your wife and move along to the hill, because at the hill is the cross. It is a personal Savior. When he was on Calvary, he was crying and shedding blood, not for you, but for me.
Amen.
Just say, he shed his blood for me. Just say that. I want to see the action. He shed his blood for me. So if he shed his blood for me, and like you say, but for you, then he shed his blood for the entire universe. He's a personal Savior. Remember Mrs. Lot. You need to forget. You need to forget even your dearest. You need to forget your God. You need to forget your God. If you're going to the Savior, because for all you know, these days there are so many gods, those with capital G and small G, but there is only one Savior, the Christ. Amen. There is only one. There is only one. And there is only one Calvary. And that blood was shed only once and for all. Only once. It can never, ever be shed again. Whether you like it, whether you believe it or not. Do not look back. And you see, the thing about moving is that you need to break the bridges. The moment you move, you need to destroy the bridge behind you. Because there is something about destroying the bridge in the army. Because when you destroy the bridge, you cannot go back. You either move or you die. The biggest problem in our Christian life, in our personal life, is we fail to destroy the bridges behind us. So it is easier the moment you find an obstacle on the way, you simply backtrack. But you see, when the bridge is destroyed, when you find when you find an obstacle ahead of you, you have no alternative of going back. The only choice that you have, whether it is right or wrong, is not an issue. The only thing is that it is the only choice that you have. The only choice that you have, the moment you destroy the bridge, is to forge your way forward. You cannot go back. The Bible says, move. You can only rest when you get to the hill. Now, if you haven't gotten to the hill, you're making a mistake to stop or pause or look back, because you're trusting the bridges behind you. You think they'll take you back. And the Lord has sent me to tell you this evening that destroy the bridge and move forward. I don't know what bridge it is. I don't know what bridge it is in your life. But you need to move. You need to move. You need to focus on where you're going, not where. You need to focus where you're going. Where you're going defines where you will pass. Don't first define the way. Because for all you know, that way might be the wrong way. Let your destination define your path. Let where you're going keep your eyes focused to your goal. Focus. Focus. Oh, I know something about focusing, ladies and gentlemen. There is something that you people, that I have not told anyone. That I got the accident. There is a part of the story I didn't say. We were friends in the car. We were having a good time. We were laughing. Now the driver of that car, who was me, was busy chatting with someone while the car was accelerating on a highway. Focusing on the good time. Forgetting where you're going. And let me tell you something, guys. I did learn a lot of science. One thing I learned in physics, that for every action, there is an opposite, an equal reaction.
Now that you learned to keep it.
Yes,
you will need it in the future.
And up to now, I'm still receiving the opposite reaction.
Up to now, the accident was 30th December. Are we together? You see, the thing about these decisions, the decision is very short, is you make it in a second. But the consequences, today, 30th January, ladies and gentlemen, I'm supposed to be dealing with this. I've not stopped yet. We are still dealing with it. Because there are two cars to be repaired. Don't look back. Forget your past. Forget. Paul in Philippians chapter 3, he says, verse 13 to 14. Let me just read that verse and I pack my bags and you guys go home. Let me just read Philippians, chapter 3, verse 13 and 14, the Bible says, brethren, I do not consider that I have made it my own. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Jesus Christ. I want to read again verse 13. Brethren, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind. What was lying behind Paul? His holiness, his Pharisaism, his blamelessness, his personal righteousness, his, you know, everything, his power, his status as a young man to sit on the Sanhedrin, forgetting his religion, Judaism, he's saying, forgetting what is in the past and putting it behind me and focusing on the goal. There is something called focusing on the goal. When you're running, you focus on the finishing line. As you get to the finishing line, you run even faster. There's a thing about football. Football players, when they are getting to the goal, they never reach, they pass the ball, is faster. Now, keeping my eyes towards the goal, I press on to the prize. Now, you cannot live in the future and in the past at the same time. Something cannot be A and B at the same time. It is either A or B. Something cannot be truth and not truth at the same time. Something cannot be the one that says and another says. There can only be one. It is either A or B. It is either Jesus who saves you or something else. And the one thing I know is that there's only one person who has power over sin, and that is Jesus. So if you have something else that saves you, I don't know where you stand. Leaving the past, focusing on the future. Leaving the past, focusing on the future. Forget the past. Do not return. Do not look back, because looking back to Sodom is returning to Satan. You know, returning to Satan is looking. You look back to Sodom, you're returning back to Satan. You're returning back to bondage. You're returning back to your prison. You see, the problem of staying in the valley is that in the valley is your resting in the world. You are a new creature. When you're in the plain, in the valley, you are a new creature. But when it calls for the new creation, you don't belong. The Lord tells you, you can only rest when you are part of the new creation, and that is when you've reached the mountain. I've come to call you this day, ladies and gentlemen, that you make a decision to move like which are laying each other. You clear the altar of the Lord and move in faith and never look back. Remember, Lot's wife.